why don't you grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me? Seriously, seriously, seriously. Sidewalk is what it's symbolic means. It's a way to travel, but it's off the main, off the street where all the cars are like zooming, zoom, 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 zoom. You're off on the sidewalk. That's where the kids are, right? The kids, the old folks and the kids. And the kids are walking along, skipping along, playing hopscotch, and they're skateboarding along and on the sidewalk. It's not the mainstream where all the traffic is going. So it's off of the mainstream. Why don't you grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me? So we symbolize that with the skateboard. It's a way of symbolizing. See, we're neither conventional nor non-conventional. You have to be geniuses. It's different. Neither the conventional nor the non-conventional is genius. Because what is genius? Genius knows the goal. See, the conventional doesn't know the goal. Non-conventional doesn't know the goal. It's just contrasting. Say, hey, I'm not conventional, so I must be hip. Now, neither one knows the goal at all. Neither one knows the goal. If you know the goal, then you know what the practice is oriented to. You know what the practice is targeting. You know where it's taking you. And you say, oh, yeah, of course I get it. Because I know if you don't know what the goal is, you're just bluffing and posing and say, yeah, I'm not conventional, you know, so I know how to do this and that. No. It's like saying you know how to meditate, but you don't know what the goal is. That's a yoga girl thing. That's posing. I'm just on retreat and we're being quiet and okay. No. That's the mistake. So why don't you grab your board and go sidewalk? I don't have that song on MP3. I should get it though, shouldn't I? So I can sing along here. I've got this little tape recorder here. I've got some MP3 songs on it, but I don't have that one. I'll get it. I'll get it. Grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me. Grab your mind, okay? What is a skateboard? Simple mind. Simple mind, isn't it? It signifies simple mind, not into power trips. Okay? Cars, big, all this, you know, bells and whistles, everyone's obsessed with their cars. But the kids, I just have a skateboard. You know, simple mind. Non-ambitious mind. The skateboard symbolizes the path, the path, the goal. Find a way to focus off the mainstream, focus on the sidewalk. Hey, we're having fun here on the sidewalk. How could you have fun? You don't even have a car. Well, actually, we're having a lot of fun here. We're doing hopscotch and we're dancing and we're singing and we're skateboarding and we're entertaining ourselves. Actually, you know how kids entertain themselves? Adults, they can't entertain themselves, can they? Say, no, I need this razzle dazzle big, you know, entertainment thing to entertain me. I need this big car to entertain me. No, the kids, they don't need that. So the skateboard is what we're using to symbolize what we're doing, the path, the real path, the immediate necessity to focus out of the mainstream, not rebel against it, but focus, positive focus, not be unconventional. We're not rebelling. We're not saying, look at me, I'm not conventional. That's a reaction. We're not reacting in that way. We're saying we know what the goal is, and we're going to reach our goal, and this is how we're doing it. Because the mainstream is madness, actually. Why do you want to be in the mainstream? And merely saying, you know, superficially, I'm not in the mainstream is still madness. Doesn't solve anything. So grab your board and go sidewalk surf with me. Get a skateboard. Go get a skateboard. Go buy a skateboard today. And bring your skateboard to Satsang. That's why I call it Skate Satsang. It is a Skate Satsang. I could call it Skateboard Satsang. Maybe I will. I just shortened it to Skate Satsang. Skateboard SBS. SBS. I don't know. Just S. Skate. Just Skate Satsang. But whatever. Bring your board to Satsang and you put it on your lap there. Okay. And it's showing, it's like Tibetan Buddhists use the Vajra and the bell and various things. You know, we have a skateboard because we're reminding ourselves, this is what we're doing. We're getting off the mainstream, but we still have a path, don't we? The sidewalk's a path, right? Sidewalk takes you where you want to go, but it's simplified. It's calm. It's simple. It's grounded. It's narrow, yeah, but it doesn't have these cars doing 100 miles an hour and frantic traffic and all this kind of stuff and beep, beep, get out of my way, hurry. Our vehicle is very simple, very basic and simple. We just use a few little adjustments with the truck wrench and the wheel wrench, just, you know, tighten and loosen just a little bit and tweak it. Oh, okay, it's good. Grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me. And this is something the ego cannot understand. The ego can never understand genuine spiritual practice. It can never understand it. It keeps saying, no, 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 do it this way. Do it in a way that I can understand. The ego doesn't know what the goal is. The ego's goal is to maintain excuses for failure. That's its only goal. So the ego says, I don't know. That's not really generating excuses for failure. I don't understand that. Of course the ego cannot understand. Again, its purpose, the ego's purpose, is to maintain excuses for failure. We're excuse addicts. Everyone in this world is an excuse addict. That we wouldn't be here if we weren't. Except for the therapists, the gurus. To come to help us. Everyone else is here because we're excuse addicts, and we believe that we need excuses to be what we are. It's that simple. And without excuses, we feel like, well, what happened? I don't feel complete anymore. All my excuses are gone. Oh my gosh, what happened to my identity? So we identify ourselves with our excuses. This is called the personality. The person, the personality, just a bundle of excuses. There's no actual I there. There's no actual identity. It's a bundle of excuses, like a bundle of twigs, a bundle of straw. Just excuses. But we're so used to excuses, failing to accept what we really are, that we think it's part of us. We believe this is God created us this way. And if we don't have excuses, we say, oh my gosh, I've changed what I am. This is terrible. I need to get back to my excuses. How do I do that? So our practice here is to practice getting used to no excuses. This is the full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow is we're neither accepting excuses nor rejecting them. Full stop on the real meditation is always off of flipping the script or assertions where you catch a glimpse of reality. It's not something you do, say, okay, I'm going to sit down and I'm going to be silent. I've never meditated that way. That's the yoga girl thing. I'm going to impose silence. That's what Buddha tried that first trance state. Says, no, that's not it. You don't impose the silence upon yourself. That's not it. Real meditation is when you catch a glimpse of your progress and you see the goal, you realize, oh my gosh, wow. Then it's allowing that wow to remain. So real meditation is a dynamic situation. We say there's three aspects to it. It's a dynamic of assertions, flipping the script, full stop on the wow. Full stop on the wow is in the middle. You flip the script and you see it. Oh my gosh, you know. That's Adi Yoga. I see it. What do you do? Well, by seeing it, it's knocked out your excuses, hasn't it? So you have to be very careful to not rush back and grab a hold of your excuses. So instead of looking at the goal, realize, hey, wait a minute. I have this extreme addiction. It's going to bite me if I'm not real careful. So let me just settle down into this wow. And not do anything at all, really. I'm not saying I achieved something or I didn't achieve something. Just neutral in your thinking. It's just neutral. Everything's just neutral. Neither this nor that. You have to acclimatize yourself to less and less excuses. Less and less excuses. More and more absence of excuses. Because again, the key trouble we have is we believe excuses are part of our identity. Okay? We're getting to the absolute bottom line truth here. And I've slept on this for several days now, so, you know, I'm good with it, no problem. Holy Spirit want me to do that. It says, just take it easy here. Just take it easy. And don't press too much. Okay. And we're not pressing, are we? We're just kinda okay. Hey, we're sidewalk surfers. You know, you see those guys and girls going down the sidewalk, and they're just kind of push, and kind of just glide a little bit. You know, they're not in too much of a hurry, are they? If you're in a hurry, you drive a car, ride a bicycle. Bicycles are going as fast as the cars now. They're always in a big hurry, the bicyclists, aren't they? Whatever happened to just cruising? Now, my skateboards are called a cruiser, but it's not like a long cruiser. They said, you know, later on you could get one of those. I said, yeah. For some reason, I wanted this one. It's a little in-between. It's a tweener, it's called. It's a cruiser, but not the long type. Some of them get really long, and I said, you know, that's just for cruising long. Maybe I'll get one, but... and then the shorter ones with the tails are up like that, and that's for doing all sorts of tricks, and the shorter ones for going real fast and doing turns and all sorts of skate park stuff. But the cruisers just kind of cruising along the sidewalk. They're actually for going fast down hills too. And I didn't want to do that, so that's why I didn't get one. I may not even do anything. I don't know. It's the board's mostly for satsang, to set the tone. Everyone comes to satsang. Bring your skateboard. Go get your skateboard. Because it's a reminder, it's a potent reminder that we are stepping onto the sidewalk, out of the heavy traffic, which is going to be a disaster. Okay. This has been pounded into me to an unbelievable extent by the Holy Spirit and the Dharma Kings. Super litigiousness is coming. Suing. Super amount of suing. When the yoga girls find out they can't get their way, they're going to start suing everyone in sight. That's what's coming. We've got some big time sewers coming. No matter what happens, we have to get out of the heavy traffic. This is absolutely crucial. And there's only one practice that works, and that is getting used to not having excuses. That's it. Now, the problem with just yoga girl meditation, yoga girl path, it doesn't know what the goal is. And so it stalls out eventually. This is what I've seen throughout history. You better be hooked up with a lineage that knows what the goal is. The problem we had in the 60s, 70s, just a lot of self-professed gurus and yoga teachers and all this kind of stuff. They just thought the goal was stress reduction. Or some kind of, you know, a little, some peace of mind or something. They didn't know what the goal was. They weren't part of this, of a lineage. And so what we have here is oversight from a number of lineages, but in particular we're using Longchenpa, who has perfect oversight and expresses it as better than anyone, really, in terms of expressing it. He's just flawless, actually, so extraordinary it's hard to even fathom how clear he is about it. And so we have that oversight. Which means we know what the goal is. And I'm glimpsing what the goal is now. I'm able to, it's coming into focus for me. I don't try to grasp it or anything. It's a matter of just, it will come into focus when I am okay with not having any excuses. You see, I know that. So you can't force it. If you try to force a glimpse of it through some practice, but the problem is then at some point you're going to say, well, that's great, but I feel incomplete and I need to balance myself out, and you go back and try to generate some clever excuses. You will generate clever excuses, and that's when the trouble arrives. That's when the wheels come off. Be very careful of those who do not have the immediate oversight of a Dharma king. I don't mean having a picture of Ram Maharshi. Everybody has a picture of Ram Maharshi, you know. But do they say, look, I'm just a functionary. I'm just working for Ramana Maharshi. He's actually guiding and directing me. And you know, are they saying that? I don't know. But here, we're saying, I am just working under Longchenpa. He asked me to help him, just a Dharma prince, not a Dharma king, not a guru, you know, Dharma prince, not a king. Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodro is my, what you know, tutor or something that is, you know, directly attached to me in terms of looking out for me, keeping me on the straight and narrow. So it's I feel super important, and to not just be, you know, completely unaligned with anything, because in studying history I can see what happens, the trouble that comes. You have people go see a teacher, then they split from the teacher, say, yeah, I'm enlightened, and I go do my thing, and then later on, it's like, oh, wow, I really got off track. What happened? This has been pretty common recently. People go see, like, a guru or a teacher for a year or two, and then they say, okay, I got it. And they go up and set up, and I'm a non-dual teacher. There's, I got the lingo, I got the this, I got the, and there's, you know, friction with the teacher. They don't really, I mean, what is that? I don't get that. Longchenpa is the boss. You know, he's running the show. There's no friction. If there's a friction, it's my fault. Period. It's not his fault at all. He's incapable of missing the mark. Totally incapable of it. He's expressed what the goal is very, very, very clearly, more clearly than anyone I've ever read or come across. So there's no confusion about what the goal is here. So since we know what the goal is, we know what the practices are for, what they're aimed at, what they're targeting, and which is we need to get familiar with not having any excuses. We have to practice this. We're incredible addicts who've been used to using the logic of addiction. Addicts have an entire logic that comes from their addiction, protecting their addiction. You know, the alcoholic who says, my problem is not that I'm drinking too much. It's that I'm not drinking enough. Okay, this is the fundamental logic of addiction. Is the problem is not that we're suing everybody, it's that we need to sue everybody much more. We're not suing nearly enough. Let's just sue everybody for everything. Problem isn't too much drugs, it's not enough. Problem isn't too much addiction, it's not enough addiction. Come on. So that's called doubling down, that the logic of addiction doubles down. And, you know, I'm very clearly aware of this, that they think they're doing the right thing. They really do. I've seen it. And you see that they're just completely becoming non-functional. They don't see it that way. They think they're on the brink of success. They just haven't quite yet done enough. And then that's going to cure everything. They know one something cures it all. They think one more drink cures it all. They got it backwards. No, it's one insight cures it all. One perspective shift. They think the alcohol is a perspective shift. Well, we didn't say any perspective shift. We said one particular perspective shift, which is going vertical. So they're just going horizontal, trying to say, if I just go more horizontal, one more push horizontally, that's it. No, going horizontally is never it, which means believing in time, space, process, and form. That's what I call going horizontally, with process, change, contrast. That's never it. Going vertical out of that is the perspective shift. Just go vertical for just, that's all it takes. And then you realize, oh my gosh, none of this has anything to do with, none of this is real. It's just an illusion. It's never been true. But we're not trying to analyze it too much here. We're just setting the stage. We're just sidewalk surfing here. Longchenpa's never met a wave that he can't ride. A big wave, okay? Big wave to him is nothing, actually. This is the perspective. Everything is self-resolved, spontaneous resolved in the now. He brings it up. Okay. But our trouble is we think our excuses are part of our identity. So we have to excuse ourselves from this vision, guru vision. He calls it guru vision. Our goal is guru vision. The goal is reachable. I'm glimpsing it. I've had now numerous glimpses of guru vision. And then I'm looking and say, okay, now why don't we stay with guru vision? Oh, because there's no need for any excuses. None whatsoever. I don't need to get anywhere. I don't need to do anything to be what I am. I already am perfectly what I am. I don't need to make an excuse for not being what I am. So there's no need for any excuses at all. So you're free. There's no excuses arising. Because all excuses are just our own mental imagination. That's all. And there's nothing out, no external dynamic generating excuses for us. We say it's the ego. No, the ego is just a term for a bundle of excuses that we think is some self or identity. The ego is like the sum total of all excuses. You know, this way of putting it, a personal ego would be our little bundle of excuses that we think we need in order to be what we are, you know, to be authentic, to be complete. But there's no actual I there or identity or anything. It's just excuses. Just excuses. That's all that it is. But we think without those excuses, whoa, I lost myself. Where did myself go? An integral part of myself disappeared. We think we need to integrate the excuses. You know, find a way to be happy with the excuses. This is yoga girl philosophy, is Oh, you know, don't worry, everybody. I know how to be happy. I can help you learn to be happy with your excuses. This is delusion. That's the Antichrist. That's what leads you down into doubling down on your addictions, which is what's coming in this world. I've been extremely fortunate, but that's I made my own good fortune by patience and discipline and determination. I've been friended by these various Dharma kings that have been helping me see what the goal really is. And then realize the practice has to be in alignment with the goal, but you know what the practice is for, so then you know how to practice. It makes sense. If you don't know what the goal is, at some point the practice is just, you say, what am I doing this for? It's absurd. What am I sitting here quietly for? So I'll be a nicer person. My excuses will be nice excuse. I'll get comfortable with my excuses. The ego says the goal is to get comfortable with our excuses. The ego says the problem is you just haven't learned how to live with your excuses. So we can help you with that. Let's breathe deeply and calmly and say, you know, I love my excuses, you know. And try to learn to love our excuses. But of course, our excuses are only there excusing our failure to accept what we really are, which is perfection. So it's like the ego saying you got to be comfortable with failure. Failure to be what you really are. But of course, the problem is we can't be anything other than what we are. We can only dream or not. So we always feel that this so-called egoic stability is being threatened. There's something threatening it. And so the ego says, yeah, as soon as I sue everybody and put them all in jail these days, maybe we don't gas them all. Maybe we just sue them all. It's kind of a different type of gassing, actually. And then as soon as that, you know, that's taken care of, then the threat's gone, that will be fine. But the dream is inherently threatened by reality. The dream of denying reality is always inherently threatened by reality. It feels threatened. Reality is not doing any action to threaten. Reality just is. But the denial of what is always feels insecure. And then when we say, oh, but we need to be happy with our excuses, then what do we do with this insecurity? We project it onto some boogeyman and then attack the boogeyman. So anyone that threatens our excuses, we see that they're the boogeyman. We have all these nice excuses, and we say, I've learned to get a nice bundle of excuses, and I'm bracing them, and that's me. I've accepted this as me. I'm trying to accept myself. And here comes a boogeyman and says, hey, you know, those are just excuses. I'm not going to accept those excuses. Ah, you're threatening me. You're threatening me. I'm going to sue you. You're threatening me. I'm going to, you know, you can't get rid of you. This is what happens. We're seeing this play out in the world. It's very much in our faces. I don't pay any attention to it because I already know what it's all about. I don't need to watch the drama. So the whole, again, the whole egoic yoga girl philosophy, which is egoic philosophy, which leads us to doubling down on our addictions, is embrace your excuses. Learn to love your excuses. Get comfortable with them. Get familiar with them, and then you'll be fine. You'll be fine. Everything will be fine. Now, the Dharma King says, no. That will never work. That leads you down into extreme misery. And I can testify that's absolutely true. I've lived the entire situation just to see, you know, who's telling the truth? Dharma kings are telling the truth. Yoga girls are lying, plain and simple. They don't know what they're talking about. And what they're good at is exploiting your addiction. We're all good at this, actually. They just happen. There's certain ones that are very clever at this, and they say, "Hey, if you know, we got to keep everybody addicted because I'm really good at manipulating and exploiting our excuse addiction." So I don't want anybody repenting. You know, no. I need all these addicts because I'm able to, you know. Addicts can be easily manipulated, right, into enslavement. Sure, I'm going to take your addiction away. Oh no, well, do this for me, then I won't. You know, oh, okay. This is what the world, special relationship is just us manipulating each other's addictions, or what the addiction, which is excuse addiction. Excuse addiction is the primary addiction, that all other addictions are just attempts to distract ourselves from it. We say, oh, I have an alcohol addiction. Yeah, oh, I'm working on that. That's just a way to not work on our excuse addiction. No, I got this really bad addiction. I got to work on this. But actually, the skills you need to get out of any addiction, you can then apply them to the excuse addiction. So, it is true that all the other addictions are just egoic tricks to try and divert our efforts and attention away from the excuse addiction. However, it comes back to bite the ego, because as you become very skillful at getting free of an addiction, you learn these techniques. You learn a lot, and then you can apply that to the ultimate addiction, the real addiction we have, which is excuse addiction. We're addicted to excuses. We think without excuses, we're incomplete. And we even go further than that. We think without excuses that somehow we've fallen into an abyss because we can't find excuses anywhere. And lack of excuses, we believe, is an abyss. So the self has fallen into some abyss, and it's falling. It says, where are my excuses? I can't find them anywhere. I'm in an abyss. You know, if there's something we feel we need in order to be what we are, and we can't see it anywhere, don't we think that must be an abyss? Yes, we do. Longchamp has said this, that our problem is we think, you know, lack of delusion is an abyss. It's exactly right. That's what our problem is. It's excuse addiction, and then without excuses, we think we fall into an abyss. Even though we have everything, we're complete. We are so used to addictions, excuses. We say, I'm missing something really integral. And I don't see it anywhere. Therefore, I must be in an abyss. Therefore, I must be in an abyss. Therefore, I must be in an abyss. This is the trouble we have. Grab your board and go sidewalk surf with me. No, serious. I'm absolutely serious. Go buy a skateboard. Start thinking about it. Don't skateboard. I'm not saying you should go out and skateboard. I haven't even skateboarded yet. It's too dangerous at this point. I have to work on my balance. I got a balance exerciser here, and I don't even know if I will skateboard, actually. I might push it around a little bit. I don't know. It's been 45 years, and but this can, here we have a little skateboard here, super mega skateboard. And just put this on your lap, put the wheels down, put the skateboard across your lap, rest your arms on the skateboard. It's actually a very nice little full stop on the wow practice. You might even have a skateboard in your closet. Get your skateboard out in your closet. It's a prop. It's a great spiritual prop we're going to use. The Holy Spirit has suggested this. We're not without props. Look at the Tibetan Buddhists. They have so many props. It's just, they have props coming out of props. Nothing wrong with that. But it's a little intimidating for those who don't understand the purpose for all these props. You know, my gosh, they got thangkas hanging everywhere. And these thangkas are super intricate. They got mandalas hanging, you know, all the lineages, you know, all their gurus. I mean, they got, you know, the accoutrements are just, it's like super saturated. And then here's the head lama, and they know how to, you know, everything. And just like, it's very amazing. Also very stunning and intimidating for those who are not Tibetan Buddhists. Here, we just have a skateboard. It's a little simpler. My add a few things along the way, but I want to keep it actually very simple. We don't want to intimidate anybody. The Tibetans are not trying to intimidate, so well, it's basically saying, look, we know what we're talking about here, and so that's how it is. You listen, you pay attention, and trust it. You got a lot of work you got to do. No, it's, you know, serious business. It's very serious business. But for somebody who's just complete, you know, a Westerner, it's just overwhelming. I don't even try to figure it out, really. No, I don't. Don't need to. We got Longchenpa here, who's really the king of all Tibetan Buddhists, and even beyond that, because he sort of superseded it all. He went beyond it all. He left. You know, he was the head of the Samye Monastery, which you might say was the highest position in Tibetan Buddhism, and he just left. He just left. Said, "I'm gonna go live in a cave. I don't need this. This is just a bunch of politics, spiritual politics here. A bunch of arrogance, and forget it." He says, "Don't get caught up in all those paths and all this religion and all this stuff. Don't get caught up in Buddhism. Just realize that one insight settles it all. Just focus on that, which is Padmasambhava. And it is said that Padmasambhava appeared to Longchenpa with his retinue and everything. Appeared, and then he just walked into Longchenpa and disappeared into Longchenpa, just disappeared into him. The real key insight is that one insight settles it all. This is the perspective shift settles it all. It settles it all. And I've experienced this. I can tell you it is true. And this is the real goal. And simply taking this as trusting in this, it saves you incalculable misery. And one practice is all we need, is simply practicing getting used to not having any excuses. That's it. So we're just sidewalk surfers here. We're not out in the ocean. The ocean just throws everything at you. You know, how many years did I surf? I know I started, I was about 8 years old, I think. I surfed until I was about 19. So it was about, you know, 10, let's say 10 years. I surfed for 10 years. I got swimmer's ear. I had to stop. I was sick too. Like, I was so feeble, I couldn't do it anymore. But I've done it all. I've done. They had skim boards. They didn't have boogie boards. They didn't have really boogie. Well, I did a lot of body surfing as well. A lot of body surfing. Yeah, that's pretty hardcore because you get pounded. I've been pounded body surfing so severely. My face hit the bottom of the sand so hard. It just about knocked me out so bad, and my whole face later peeled, all the skin peeled, because it somehow just separated the skin from my face. I hit so hard. I was body surfing some very wedgie-like waves. Used, you know, the flippers. I've had the flippers, and I didn't get into, what do they call it, bodyboarding so much. Bodyboarding, I'd like to, because those son of a guns, you know, it was easy for them. They had the flippers. They could paddle, flip, flip, and get in the wave and do all this bodyboarding and stuff. But I experienced the ocean in every which way. That is for sure. And let me tell you, the ocean is a scary place. Don't mess around with the ocean. You have to respect the ocean in terms of what it can do and what your limits are and how you feel. And Boy, you don't take an arrogant approach to the ocean. It humbles you. It really humbles you, the ocean. It might seem nice and calm, but when it gets stirred up, sometimes you better head for shore, I'm telling you. I mean, they're big wave surfers that look at like mavericks and say, no, I'm not going out. I'm not going out. Not today. Not today. I'll pass. I'm gonna pass on this. Yeah, I don't feel good. I'm a little injured, I tweak my back, this is it. Hey, it looks angry. The ocean looks real angry today. They can feel it. They're in tune with the ocean. They could feel the ocean. You got to be able to feel it. The ocean's a metaphor for the world, for our mind, the mind of the world, the ego. You know, sometimes the ego seems kind of calmish and going along, not too grouchy. Sometimes it gets real grouchy. Sometimes the ocean gets angry, really angry, and really stirred up. And at that point, you need to grab your board and go sidewalk surfing. Okay. This is the key, what we're saying. This is not coming from whimsicality. This is coming from deep experience here. I've been out in very stormy weather. I used to go out in the most stormy weather in the ocean. Just by the challenge. I wanted to experience it. And it's, when you're out there just way out from shore and there's not many people around. We didn't even used to have tethers, leashes for the boards. If you lose your board, you're lost at sea. I mean, you got to swim in somehow. It was very scary. You feel the ocean out there, and it's scary. It's adrenaline pump, you know, is what it is. You're pumping adrenaline. So adrenaline addicts go out there, you know, there's no escaping it. But there's a point where you realize I've had enough. You head for shore. Now, there's also a point when you're experienced and you've cheated death a few times where you take the reed of the ocean from the shore. The wind, the swell. These days they have a lot of, you know, buoy readings and know what's coming. They know what's coming. The tide, the currents, how you feel, your mental mood, your mental focus, your commitment. You take everything into account, 360 degrees, and you may be there with your wetsuit and your board and everything ready to go. But you watch the real experienced surfers. They're just there on the shore, just watching it all. You know, and sometimes they say, nah, not today. I feel like doing something today, but not this. So what do they do? They go home, break out their skateboard, go skateboard, you know, in their patio, go skateboard down the sidewalk. They want a little action, okay? Balance, yeah, I'm doing this, okay. But today it's going to be sidewalk surfing for me. You might see Laird Hamilton skating on a skateboard at some point, right? He may just look at it and say, this looks like death to me today. I'm not into dying. You know, the big wave surfers aren't into dying. That's why they don't die, because they're not into it. If you're into dying, you'll be dead. Being a big wave surfer, you most certainly will be dead. So they look at a wave, they said, no, they're not into dying. They're into surviving. So they may just say, no, not today. Today looks like a death day. I'm not going out. Those are the real big wave surfers. Not the show-offs. The show-offs are saying, oh, really? Laird doesn't want to go out today? I'm going to go out and I'm going to ride the waves that Laird's scared to ride. Well, guess what? You do that enough times and it's sayonara. More like auf Wiedersehen, because you're going to transmigrate. There's really no death, there's just transmigration. Death doesn't exist, actually. No such thing. Everything's just transmigrating. That's all that's happening. all these appearances just are just transmigrating, morphing into another appearance. That's all. It's just all this morphing taking place in terms of this dream. So, if like Laird Hamilton told you, he's the greatest big wave surfer in history. If he told you, you know what, hey, if you say, hey, Laird, what do you think of the waves today? Should I go out? If he looks at you and says, well, if you want to die, you should go out. But if you don't want to die, I recommend not going out. I say, are you going out? Say, no, I'm not going out. Now, maybe he could. Okay. But he's setting an example for everybody else because he sees all these kooks on the shore, you know, wanting to ride these waves, and he says, hey, it's gonna, they can't handle it. I know they can't handle it, so I'm not gonna go out. So they don't go out, because if I go out, they'll go out also. You see how that works? The most mature minds set an example. Maybe they could handle it. Like Longchenpa, he could handle any wave because there's no wave. But for us, he realizes we don't see it that way yet. We're not stable in our perspective shift yet. We're not stable any. I've glimpsed it, but I'm not stabilizing it. Was it called Samatha or something in Tibetan Buddhism of stabilizing in the view? Okay, that there's two. They analyze it, and then they flip the script, and then they do invocations or what we call assertions, and then they work on stabilizing in the perspective shift, which is really just getting used to not having any excuses. Now, this is just the way that has to be done. It's not just Tibetan Buddhism or anything. No, it's this is just the way it has to be done. So we're not yet stabilized in no excuses. So you can't have Longchenpa saying, oh yeah, I could go out and ride those waves, because you know what, we're going to say, oh yeah, okay, I got to try it too. Isn't this how it works? If the hero says, yeah, I'm going out there to battle, then all the other little wannabe heroes follow suit. But what if the hero says, no, now I'm not touching these waves, no way, not today, I'm going sidewalk surfing. And Laird Hamilton turns around and says, hey everybody, let's go skateboarding today. You know what everybody will say? Most people will say, hey, you know what, sounds like a good idea. There'll be a few idiots that try to say, oh, here's my chance to show I'm better than Laird, so I'm going out. There's always some of those. Here's a chance to make my mark. I can handle it, the waves. Yeah. Maybe, you know, what's going to happen is they're going to get injured severely. Maybe they're going to die. Maybe they're going to get severely injured. Or maybe they're going to get severely scared, so they quit. One of those three is going to happen. None of those are good. I mean, you know, Laird might have seen, look, the waves, the way the tide, the wind, everything, the waves are sucking up too much at the takeoff. And you think you've caught the wave and you're taking off, and the lip suddenly sucks up so severely, it just pulls you right up and just flips you down, and just you have this insane free fall wipeout. Too dangerous. You can't really drop in properly. It's not possible. Whereas other people may not see that. They just see the chance for glory here. Hey, I'm going to ride a dangerous wave. Wow. I mean, you got to make the takeoff properly, or else you're going to wipe out, and that's bad news, really bad news. And you're not going to get respect of others, because you might get lucky, or, you know, but later on, I was out there riding the waves, and yeah, well, how was it? Well, I was like, too scary. It was like, I was lucky I didn't get killed. Well, you know, it was kind of stupid to go out then, wasn't it? And you have to be able to say, at that point, you have to repent and say, yeah, I was like, I was just trying to be a, you know, I was just going for glory and trying, my arrogance got the best of me. I was stupid. Nobody really respects someone who's stupid and is going for Gloria in it's too dangerous situation, because they say, hey, you could have tempted me to go out and I might have gotten killed out there. That's stupid. So the thing is, if you do that, you got to repent and say, hey, everybody, I really have to acknowledge that was an ego trip I was on. Let's play it Longchenpa's way now. He says, don't go out, but don't go out. If he says, go sidewalk surfing, we go sidewalk surfing. So again, only the arrogant ones will mock the ones on the sidewalk doing sidewalk surfing when the surf is too dangerous. And they'll say, oh, look at those chickens. You know, what are they doing? They're sidewalk surfing. That's hilarious. You know, bunch of kooks, man. They can't handle it. But you might have some of the best big wave surfers in the world just skateboarding. Today, right now, it's skateboard time, folks. It's not time to ride the big waves right now. I quit golf because I was getting ready. I said, I have to overpower the golf course. I got to get super fit because that's the only thing that will work, actually, right now, is you really have to just overpower it. There's a lot of the golfers, the young golfers now, this is the style, is they're like the Incredible Hulk. They're these big, super athletic, you know, their whole life they've been working out, fanatics. And their goal is just to overpower the course. But then I realized, out on the golf course, I just felt immediately, that's not the answer. Time to step away. Step away from it. When we step away, we're not, time to go sidewalk surfing. Because the temptation is going to be in these times to try to overpower the situation, overpower it. It's like the bigger the wave, I think the more we need to try to overpower it. Well, guess what? We're just not up for that challenge at all. Because the real goal is to see there's nothing there at all to overpower. Nothing's happening at all. Nothing is separate from its own intrinsic spaciousness at all. Nothing ever is. No matter what dance is being danced. A corpse and a living body are exactly the same in intrinsic spaciousness. Neither one is separate from it in the slightest bit. Nothing's ever happened to our abidance in intrinsic spaciousness. Nothing's happening to it at all. There's no wave at all. So the goal is not to learn to ride these big dangerous waves, these phases in egoic excuse making, is to simply realize that there are no waves. I don't know what's going on here. Oh, a squirrel's dropping nuts. There's the squirrel. And it's hitting stuff down below. It's making a loud noise. Okay. So the nuts are being fragmented and they're hitting, making large noises. For some reason, I'm having trouble speaking because I guess this is very intense information. Tiger Woods overpowered the course, but every facet of his game was so brilliant that he could get away with that. You see? But he didn't get away with it forever because it injured him. So for now, we sit it out. We're sidewalk surfers. Do you get that? We're sidewalk surfers. We're not trying to ride these overpowering waves. We think if we ride the overpowering wave, that its power becomes ours. This is classic egoic delusion that throughout history, throughout the history of humanity and consciousness, it is. Humanity is just a continuation of this dream of consciousness. The idea is if you defeat something more powerful, really powerful, then that power becomes yours. It's battle as part of that, hunting, you know, thrill seeking, all this stuff. You say, the power of this wave could not defeat me, so I'm more powerful than this wave. It's a power thing. Now, our goal, Atta Yogin goal, is to realize there's nothing, there's no power at all happening. There's zero empowerment happening. There's no accumulation whatsoever of process. There's no process taking place. There's merely a dance of light taking place to give the illusion of process. But again, our goal is to practice getting used to not having any excuses. If there's no process, how could there be excuses? You see the truth, and then you realize, wait a minute, the excuses can't possibly even exist. And then you say, well, wait a minute, excuses aren't excuses part of my identity? And then you lose sight of the guru vision. Automatically you will. There's no way around that. There's no way to get cute with this at all. There's no way to get cute with it. And the yoga girls think there's a way to get cute with it. You know, they're cutie pies. There's no way to get cute with it. I had a dream last night where I was just these workers were just about done. And then this woman appeared, this yoga girl. She had this package of curlers, foam curlers in all different colors. And she goes, aren't you guys forgetting something? You need this, and I have this. They were asking for her to pay the bill, and she goes, pay the bill? Not so fast. She goes, I have something you need. And what she was really bargaining is just, look, you waive the bill, and I'll give you these foam curlers, meaning cuteness. You need the cuteness. I got the cuteness you need. And the worker said, no, we don't need that. We don't need cuteness at all. You can't get cute with truth. There's no possibility. We have this practice. And she was like, what? No, you need it. You need it. And she kept insisting, no, you need these. You need the cuteness. She's unaware, of course, right spiritual practice. So she's just concluding it's not possible. That the excuses are part of identity. So you have to get cute with it. And these construction workers are saying, no, we don't. We don't need that. Because they've been working on the real work, the foundation work. And she thought she could, get them to do all this work for her, and then she wouldn't have to pay it. Just said, no, I'll blackmail you. So I'll, you have to have this, and I have it, and I won't give it to you unless you do this work for free for me. And they said, no deal, no deal, no deal. So that's how the dream ended. It's like the yoga girl's going, what? I'll sue you. I'll sue you. I'll make up some lawsuit, So it's going to get real nasty here, folks. Real nasty. Chances of Trump winning are very slim. Okay, virtually nil, because all the invested power interests don't want him to be president, plain and simple. The New World Order doesn't want it. The Vatican doesn't want it. The big corporations don't want it. The media doesn't want it. The entertainment industry doesn't want it. The lobbyists don't want it. Wall Street doesn't want it. All the rest of the countries in the world don't want it. You tell me how Trump's going to get elected, Or he's a no-excuse guy. Basically says, hey, that's an excuse. I'm not going to put up with that excuse. That's an excuse. Who are you trying to kid? And this, freaks out the excuse makers completely. Says, no. We're helping you get comfortable excuses. Buy this. This'll work for you. Help you get comfortable. So it's like 99% likely. I don't know. I haven't asked who's going to win or because that's a distraction. But it's extremely likely that Hillary Clinton is going to be president of the United States. Extremely likely. And that's a disaster. We have to be ready for that disaster. She's super litigious. She's a lawyer. And she feels her power is lawsuits. And she stands for the lawsuit industry, the feminists, the radical feminists, their road to power has been through legal pressure. That's all they know. They have been bullied and intimidated the entire country legally to bow to them, the radical feminists have. Hillary Clinton's a radical feminist. And the means of functionality that they use is legal pressure, intimidation. That's it. Do you really think the leopard changes its spots? There's zero indication of that. And you're banking your destiny on zero indication the leopard will change her spots, and that's what you're hoping will happen? That kind of hope is what generates fear within you. Severe fear. I don't have fear like that. I'm aware of the disasters that are coming, but I don't fear them. Not so much. I realize it's like a go thing, like pressure. I feel the pressure, sure, but I'm not in panic mode or anxiety mode. It's very different. I just say, Longchampa, we need you. Thank you for helping us out so much. It's like you're a surfer and you think you're supposed to ride the waves, and the surfer girls are saying, hey, don't back down from the waves, guys. And you're on the beach and this massive swell, a nasty swell, nasty wind, nasty everything arises. And you're on the beach with your board, and the surfer girls are posing, real cute, like, hey, you could have a lifetime of this cuteness if you just go out and ride those waves, boys. Lifetime of suntan bodies and blonde hair and mini skirts and all this stuff. Cuteness, frills of cuteness. But you got to go out and ride those waves, boys. And you're sitting on the beach and you're like shaking and trembling. And you just look at the waves and you're saying, trying to find a way. And you say, I think these waves are going to kill me. I can't handle this. I mean, I don't know anyone who can handle this. And they're looking at you. Your girls are looking at you. You know, wink, wink, wink. Like, I'm waiting. I'm waiting. I can't wait forever, guys. And so you're like desperate. You're desperate. You're desperate. And then onto the beach walks Laird Hamilton with his guns, you know, the board, and his like Superman body, and his resume, most awesome resume in history. And he looks at, he waves, hey, hi guys. You say, oh my God, that's Laird Hamilton. And he just said hello to me. What's going on here? I'm just a kook. I'm an idiot. Laird Hamilton said hello to me on the beach here. And that's just like a stunner. And for a moment, your attention's off the surfer girls. And it's on to Laird Hamilton. And it's like, and the surfer girls are all kind of flustered, like, what's going on here? I got to get my guy to die for me. Or be so injured and wiped out that he's infantized. So it looks to me as his mother. I can control him my whole life. I can manipulate his addiction. That's what they want. But now here's Laird Hamilton. Laird Hamilton just came up to me and said, hey, how you doing today? It's like Longchenpa came up to me. Hey, hi. Talking, chatting with me. Longchenpa, I was chatting with Longchenpa. I was like, I didn't know who it was, but I realized this guy just walked across the water. He just walked across the ocean. He didn't surf across it or take a boat or plane. He just walked across it. I said, what the heck? Wow. And he's just chatting with me. You know, just in a friendly, relaxed way. Like one surfer to another. You know, they're just chatting with the guy, one surfer to another. One big wave surfer to another. Yeah, what do you think? Waves. I said, I don't know, Laird. Looks kind of hairy out there. He laughs his head. Yeah. It's really hairy today, isn't it? So, we ask him, are you, we don't even ask him if he's going out. Of course he's going out, we think. So, he sticks his board in the sand, you know, sits, relaxes, and stretches, chatting with us some more, and so he's not going out yet, so we're not going out. We're waiting for him to go out. Well, the surfer girls are now, like, kind of freaking out. They're kind of like, maybe they're taking their clothes off, taking their bikinis off or something. They're you know, dancing or, hey, guys, singing a song. Hey, guys, woohoo, woohoo, over here, you know. But we're like, well, yeah, hey, hi, you know, yeah, I see you, yeah. But I'm not going out till Laird's going out, man. I respect, you know. I'm not. What? Who am I to go out in the waves if he hasn't gone out yet? Come on, I'm waiting for him. I'm waiting for Laird to go out. What are you guys waiting for? Come on, you need to be infantized. These waves will do a good job on you, beat the heck out of you, if you survive them. But no. Longchenpa's on the beach. And Longchenpa's not going out in the waves. So, eventually we might ask him, hey, Laird, so what do you think? You're going out right now or are you waiting for something? He says, nah, I'm gonna wait. I'm not going out. I'm not going out in these ways right now. Where they are right now, it's not safe. It's not safe. I'm not into, you know, dying. I'm going to tell you fellas something. You know, I didn't get to where I got to be today by dying, right? See my resume? How'd I get my resume? Did I get it by dying? Now, if I was dead, I wouldn't have been able to accumulate this resume. Come on. You say, wow, that's right. The yoga girls are scowling at this point. And then they start mumbling and hear them say, I'm going to sue you guys. But you remember you did something I didn't like, or it's kind of iffy. I'm going to sue you for that. If you don't go out in the ways, I'm going to sue you. So immediately when they realize you're not going out, things are not going the way they want it to go, lawsuits. And this is what I've been aware of. They've been blackmailing us all along. I went along with it to find out what are they doing? What are they really up to? They knew they'd reach this point where they'd have to pull that, the joker out of their sleeve. And it says, well, we're going to sue you. So what happened to the cutie? Well, the cutie is now going to hit you with some extreme lawsuit, rape or something. They're going to file charges against you, whatever. They say, well, that was consensual. Well, I'm going to say now it wasn't. I'm going to say I'm a victim. So they're going to claim victimhood and that they're going to sue you. They say, I'm going to sue you, civil lawsuit or something. So there's going to be a massive expansion of the boundaries of lawsuits. There's already been an incredible expansion of it by the POTUS of the last 8 years, and really over the last 20 some odd years. But basically, society controlled through fear of legal consequences to an extreme extent. And basically, just saying in a civil suit, it's like my word against yours, yoga girl's word against yours, against server boy's word, yoga girl wins 100% of the time. She says this, you say that, he said, she said, she said wins 100% of the time. You don't have a chance. So you say, well, I better take my chances riding the waves then, so she'll be cute and say, oh. But all she wants to do is exploit your vulnerability, your addiction, your excuse addiction. Just exploit it. So you become a slave. You're the child, she's the mother. She says, I want this, you get her this. This is what's happening. It's about materialism, spiritual materialism. So with Hillary Clinton, she's the mother of all lawsuit, sewers, a mother of all, let's expand our legal options here. She's totally into that. There's no brakes at all. You'll have every feminist in the world suing everybody. Okay? No restraint whatsoever. You will, it, this will be worldwide suing the men. Okay? It'll be just the most litigious situation you've, beyond anything you can ever imagine. There will be millions and millions and millions of lawsuits filed everywhere. Men will just be buried in lawsuits. Won't be able to do anything at all. Won't be able to function at all. And of course, if the men agree to be slaves in perpetuity to the yoga girl's cuteness, comfort, then we'll withdraw the lawsuits. We've settled out of court. It's called settling out of court. Hillary Clinton and her husband Billy are hardcore, let's sue 'em until they're dead types. But more than that, let's expand the scope of lawsuits. I mean, Trump's nasty with lawsuits himself. If you mess with his business, if you try to, destroy his business interests or something, he'll protect them for sure. He's nasty with that. He's nasty lawyers. He says, my lawyers are nastier than your lawyers. But that's a battle over money. Okay, it's not a battle over your spirit. The feminists are after your spirit. They want to enslave you to your excuse addiction. They want to say there's no way you can be free of your excuse addiction. So the only thing we can do is get comfortable with our excuses. And I'm the spokeswoman for comfort. So you need to keep me comfortable so I show you how to be comfortable. This is what's happening in the whole world, right? This is the yoga girl trick. They're the cuties, 80 years old. They're walking down, in their sneakers and miniskirt with their dog, with a diamond collar on the dog, with a beautiful house in Florida. And the man's dead, of course. And yeah, I'm so comfortable and cute. And I'm 80, and I'm still cute. Everybody wants to be a yoga girl. And the road Hillary Clinton will show them the way to be a yoga girl like her. Filthy, filthy, filthy rich. Never, never done anything in her life, really. She'll show everybody, all the women of the world, how to be yoga girls. Sue, 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 Sue. Her name should be Sue Clinton. Intimidate, legal intimidation. How do you use the justice system to be comfortable for the rest of your life? So the entire world of women are yoga girl wannabes at this point. And Hillary Clinton is their god, their idol. And they say she's the way for me to have that oceanfront condo in Florida with my little dog and my Mercedes and my beauty parlor appointments. And, you know, I'm just cruising. Of course, we're cruising with our skateboards yelling, cowabunga, you know, hopscotch hodads and pedestrians too, the little yoga, 80-year-old yoga girls walking her dog, and you like cruise by, you know. What? So in case people haven't been paying attention, I have been paying attention, so I can alert you to this. You know, the yoga girls conquered the university system. They conquered the corporate structure. They're trying to conquer the Catholic Church. They're on the verge of conquering everything in the world through threats of lawsuits, destroying you through public image, news. They use the news to intimidate you, right? If you don't bend to our will, we're going to create this huge fuss. We're going to file a discrimination lawsuit, a sexual harassment lawsuit. We're going to destroy your reputation. They're trying to destroy the Silicon Valley venture capitalism. They're working on it. They haven't quite done that yet. Still, you know, a lot of men in venture capitalism. Recently, there was an effort to really fire a shot into that. It failed, but it's ongoing. They just, some women just claim sexual harassment, discrimination, something, which was bogus because made it all up pretty much. So fantasy in her mind about it. You know, it's a rough tub of world. And she just said, no, you're not making it comfortable enough for me to succeed with my excuses. I've got all these excuses, but you're not buying my excuses, and that's unfair to me. So she sued him. And because she was a woman, she expected she would win. And when she didn't win, she demanded a whole bunch of money, and it is, you know, got real nasty. This is what they do, okay? And corporations are terrified of that. Of course, venture capitalists had really good lawyers. They could afford them. But eventually, they'll lose too. Believe me. The radical feminists have never met a foe that they can't beat legally, okay? They've rigged the Supreme Court. Okay? The Supreme Court's rigged. So the entire legal system is rigged now by the radical feminist. And Hillary Clinton is going to use that legal system to just crush everything and say, guess what? All women, yoga girls forever. Yoga girl comfort forever. On the backs of what? On the backs of men. Enslavement of men. We're back to matriarchy, enslavement of males, which religion was designed to free men from that enslavement, which is throughout most of human history, it's been a matriarchal enslavement of men. I want that. Warriors, go get that for me. Your job is a warrior. Sacrifice your life for me. I want that over there. I want that kingdom. I wanted to. That's it. She gets the generals or the matriarchy has these generals who know how to train the men and direct them in battle and say, okay, general, you know, go get that for me. They might eventually use figureheads of like a male king or something, but the queen was the one that was really ruling. But before that, they didn't even have a figurehead, a male figurehead. You just had these warriors and then the queen bee telling him, this is what I want. Go get it for me. That was most of human history has been that way. And then religion was brought in to say, hey, look, you know, this is enslavement. This is egoic, you know, insanity. We need to start. And then the men said, hey, You mean I don't have to sacrifice my life continuously for this greed and vanity and egoic insecurity? No, God doesn't ask you to do that. Really? There's a God? Yes. I thought it was the God, only the goddess. No, no. There's an actual God that's higher than the goddess. And this God tells you, you don't have to sacrifice yourself for egoic ambition and arrogance. You can actually realize this and be free of transmigration. Really? Wow. So, religions started to gain some traction in this world. And of course, the yoga girls hate religion. They want to get rid of it. And it's not enough to have like one guru, nice guru, wonderful guru, however wonderful the guru is. No, you need the legacy and the lineages. And that's why the Tibetans stress the lineages. It's so important. It's not about just one guru. It's about the legacy. Okay, the legacy is important. And what they're trying to do is destroy the legacy by just focusing on one guru and then pull the, you know, female guru and then pull the rug from out from under you legally from the whole entire thing. Then you're left with nothing. You're left with nothing. They're trying to use Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma for that, but she pulled the rug out from under them. They tried to use that with me, but you know what she did? She says, I want you to learn about all these legacies. Forget about me. It's not about me. It's about these legacies. I want you to be very grounded in these legacies. Because they're trying to use me. They're trying to use some female figurehead. They tried to. They tried to make her the number one female figurehead in the world. The period. The divine mother of the world figurehead. She flat out turned him down. That's exactly what they tried to do. The powers behind the scenes says, this is perfect. We make you the one figurehead. Everybody abandons their legacies and traditions. We focus on you. And then, since you're female, it's easy then for people then to slip their focus off onto the radical feminists. And then the matriarchy returns, enslavement of men, all this stuff. Easy. And she said, it's not in the cards. It's not in my kayal to do that. It's not in, God is not asking me to do that. She says, I go according to this inner grace that informs me what to do. That's not in the cards. She didn't do it. And so I was like, hey, you're the greatest guru. You know, no one's ever been better. Why don't we just use you? That's fine. She goes, no, 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 no. Get solid with Jesus. Find out all about Jesus, she said. Find out about the Christian legacy. Really understand the Christian legacy. Okay. And then when I really got that, she goes, Tibetan Buddhist legacy. Really find out about the Tibetan Buddhist legacy. Really be grounded in Buddhism too. Hinduism. Really find out about the legacy. Be grounded in all that. Be grounded in these great legacies. Forget about me. So I did. I said, but it's kind of hard to forget about you. He says, well, I'll help you. Yeah, don't focus on me so much. He's still doing that. He's saying, look. So I see the trap now. It's like, wow. It's the Hillary Clinton trap. It's easy to go from, if you're putting all your marbles in this one female guru, it's easy then to start idolizing something to a female powerful figure like Hillary Clinton. Because you're used to that, right? It's only that. Where's her legacy? Where's Hillary Clinton's spiritual legacy? Where's her legacy? I can point to Jamyang Kensi Choki Lodro. And he can point to Jamyang Kensi Wangpo. And he can point to Jikmi Lingpa. Right? And he can point to Longchenpa and the transmissions of it that he received from Longchenpa. Right? And Longchenpa can point to Padmasambhava. And Padmasambhava can point to Samantabhadra. You know, the completely formless, you know, reality. They all can point to that. So, and they can point to all the practices they did. Longchenpa can point to a lifetime of meditating in a cave. Jam Yankin can point to all the empowerments he received. Massive, massive, massive experience and empowerment. A lifetime of spiritual guru vision. Jam Yankin can point to a lifetime of guru vision. And I can point to Jam Yankin. See? And Longchenpa, Padmasambhava. Guru vision. What can Hillary Clinton point to except lawsuits and scandal and beating, you know, legally beating the scandal back and empowering herself at the point of a lawsuit, at the threats of lawsuits? I'm sure she said, "Bill, you know, I could drag you through the cleaners, Bill. You know that?" Yeah, Bill's gallivanting about. She goes, "Look, I could destroy your reputation, Bill, but instead I just want you to help me be president. I'll overlook all that stuff. I'll overlook that." You know, so it's blackmail. They're expert blackmailers, actually. You may think they're nice because if blackmail works, there's no lawsuit, right? They say, "Look, it's either lawsuit or blackmail. You choose. It's the hangman's choice." So don't think that just that I'm on Facebook and posting pictures of Sri Srinanda Miles. Don't think I'm not aware of what's going on. I am. She made sure that I'm aware of it. She threw some curveballs. I said, "Whoa, wow, I see that, wow." She's no fool. Don't think if you just pray to Sri Srinanda Miles that she's going to then agree with your agenda. Not at all. Not at all. She never did. That's why the devotees looked like they're so upset and beating their head against a wall. Like, no matter what I do, you know, she doesn't agree to my agenda. I said, "Ma, I've worshipped you my whole life, and can't you at least cut me some slack?" And no, I can't. Sorry. Maybe she'd cry. You know, but no. I was like, "What? I thought we had a deal." She said, "Well, you know, for some reason I can't keep deals. I didn't know we had a deal, but sometimes I'm not able to." So you never can blackmail her. You say, "Look, I'll worship you forever if you just, you know, go along with this, you know, egoic enslavement of men." She says, "No, I guess you're out of luck with that one." So some very unhappy faces are coming. So she's not a guru. She's not a guru. I'm nobody's guru. You know, you don't expect me to do what you want me to do. You can't handle me that way. You can't blackmail me. You can't say, "Guru, I've been so loyal to you, now you can be a little loyal to me," and, right? No. She says, "Don't look at me that way. You'll be disappointed." It's true. They thought they could reel me in? No. I just wanted to see. I wanted to see, you know, what's going on. She said, "Okay, take a look at this." Okay, that's the way I am. I do take a look at stuff, and so I see it. Say, "Wow. Indeed. Indeed, indeed, indeed." They're trying to destroy the Christian legacy. So it's been indicated it's safer to be part of the Longchenpa legacy. I'd love to be part of Jesus' legacy. He's my favorite. There's no question about it. There's no question. Out of all the Dharma kings, Jesus is my favorite. Because I've lived the legacy, you know, we're part of being growing up in a Western Christianized society and such. I'm very aware of his legacy. And I love his legacy. But there's such an intense effort to confuse it all right now that it's been indicated that it's safer to go over to Longchenpa's legacy Papa Sama Longchenpa, Jamie Kenzie, Choki Lodro, Tibetan Buddhist legacy. It's way safer. It's more effective. That's okay. That's fine with me. You know, it doesn't mean I think anything less of Jesus at all. I just understand the pragmatism of it. The spiritual path is pragmatic. The Holy Spirit's pragmatic. The Holy Spirit's not saying it's Jesus or nothing. Is that pragmatic? No, that's a trap. Those who've been trying to trap us into Jesus are nothing. It's all set up. It's a yoga girl set up for these times. Because once they confuse the legacy of Jesus, the people who say it's Jesus or nothing, they're going to be putty in the hands of the yoga girls. They'll end up trying to ride those waves and get killed or die, or, you know, just it's a disaster for them. Jesus never said it's my way or nothing. He never said that. In A Course in Miracles, he says there's thousands and thousands of ways and teachers and curriculum, you know, so many. And those work too. He says this is just one of those ways that will help some of you. He did say that he's in charge of the overall plan, God's plan of salvation, the overall perspective. Well, that's fine. But that doesn't mean that, you know, this way is the only way. No, not at all. Tibetan Buddhism is also a way. It most certainly is. They've had fabulous success with it. Back in the day. I don't know about now, but back in the day, certainly they did. Glorious success. Christianity had a lot of glorious success as well. So has Hinduism. So has Islam. So has various, you know, whatever. You know, there's been a lot of success throughout history in various ways. And Jesus says there's just so many different ways throughout the cosmos, traditions and ways. He's aware of all of that. Course of Miracles was a way for certain types. Certain makeup, academic makeup, into using relationships in business and academia and collaborating, the scientific mind, the collaboration with colleagues and all this stuff, and how to use that collegiality of all that to use that, you know, as your path. That's just one path. I'm much more of like a hermit type, but that path really doesn't work for me. Jesus understands that. But along with that path, he explained everything. He gave total grounding in what the trouble is. You know, best explanation ever, in my opinion, for me. But I don't use the I'm not in academia. I don't have any colleagues in terms of, you know, I don't have any friends. I don't hang out with anybody. So like I'm a hermit, like monastic, like a what do you call it? A hermit, very reclusive. I'm not nearly as much as I used to be, but the Course Miracle community, I just don't belong to it at all, really. I've never had anyone invite me into it or welcome me into it or anything like that. I've had a yoga girl say, "Hey, why don't you come to our conference?" You know, meaning, let me know. We're the ones running it. I say, "Okay, let me see. This yoga girl." To sign up, this one, and then to talk, kind of get oriented to this year. I say, it's all yoga girls running the whole conference. They're basically going to say, look, this is how we run things here, and you're subservient to us. We have legal leverage over you, and is that acceptable to you? And they're using the bait of this, you know, teacher of A Course in Miracles or something for that. And I said, thanks, but no thanks. You know, if such and such wants to hang out with me, they're free to come hang out with me. I mean, my talks are just as inspired as theirs, if not more so. I'm not deficient in that. It's like a singer. You say, hey, come sing this, come hear this singer or this band. I say, why? I can entertain myself here just as good as going to see that singer. I can sing my own song just fine. I don't need to go there. If they want to come here, well, let's sing harmony together. I'm fine. I'd be happy for that. happy to do that. But I'm not putting myself under the gun of the yoga girl gun. No way. It's all about legal leverage they have now. They have virtually total legal leverage right now in Western society, certainly in the United States. And they're getting it through the United Nations. They're getting it. The purpose of the United Nations is to extend the yoga girl legal leverage to the entire planet, which is to then wipe out any hope we can be free of transmigration, to wipe that out. At which point you go insane. Because, you know, hope and fear go together, right? If you minimize hope to virtually gone, what arises? Fear. Because we're actually terrified that we might somehow be separate from reality. We don't want that, really. We're terrified that we might have to transmigrate forever. We don't want that, actually. Deep down, we're really, really worried that, and so when you hear Longchamp, I says, no, you're already free of it, actually. It's a perspective shift. You were never in it. Oh, thank God. You know, this feels, thank God. Such relief, thank God. When you remove that, any hope that you can be free of transmigration simply by not even asking the question, no, they say, well, we're human beings. I mean, what do you talk about? We're human beings. This is our world, the world, you know. That is an attempt to remove the hope, because there's only transmigration happening. There's not death happening at all. See, it's a shocker to hear that, isn't it? We think we die, we're free. No, there's no death. We're just transmigrating. We're morphing into some other form somewhere, you know, another realm. To have all attention shift off of that key issue in our spirit, to ignore it completely, you know what? That drives us into panic. Extreme fear. And then we latch on to excuses and become rigid about it. And then everybody else that threatens that little bundle of excuses, they're evil, they need to be crushed. We'll crush them physically, we'll crush them financially, we'll crush them legally, but we will crush them. And of course, the yoga girl's saying, we do it in a nice way, we crush them legally. And then if you want to think, oh, I want to be a nice person too. I don't want to be seen as a heavy, you know, a goon. So let's elect Hillary Clinton president. We can all crush those who threaten our bundle of excuses. Just annihilate them legally. And we'll still be nice people. We'll be real, we'll still think of ourselves as, I'm a wonderful person. So can you feel this trap that's been set? It most certainly has been set. And the idea of the way of Christianity is the only way is a trap. What Jesus really said was repentance is the only way, which is true. But anyone can repent. You don't need labels, Christian labels, to repent. You don't need any particular labels. You could use any labels you want, actually. Just like the Holy Spirit, you don't have to call it the Holy Spirit. You could call it Parashakti, or Avalokiteshvara, Avalokiteshvara, you know, Tibetan Buddhism, Avalokiteshvara, Parashakti, Divine Grace, anything, you know, you can use any term you want. Still, it's still the grace of God. It's still the play of attention. It's the play of attention coming from God, coming from reality, helping us out. How are we doing here? Pretty good. Okay. I lose track of time. I'm not paying attention to time at all. I'm supposed to warm up. You know, the internet weather predictions are officially crazy. I've been noticing this. It's getting worse and worse and worse. The long-term forecast is, it's not worth. They must have robots doing it. I swear. It's ridiculous. I say, cool down. I looked at the long-term forecast a couple days ago. You know, low 80s, high 70s. Okay, I could plan accordingly. Okay, my workout schedule, I kind of need to plan it according to how hot it is, right? Yeah, you think? I mean, if you have a workout schedule, you do lower body one day, upper another day, core balance, this day. And as far as doing workouts with lower work legs, you don't want to do it if it's blazing hot. You could have a heat stroke. So I kind of need to know. So I look at how, so I look at the long-term forecast. Well, they say the upper 70s, real cool spell, a lot of fog. Well, I said, wait a minute. The last 3 days have been 92. You completely missed it by 10 degrees every day. That's a difference between heat stroke and no heat stroke for me. So I'm not happy at all. I'm very unhappy with weather.com and AccuWeather and Weather Underground. They must have a bunch of, chimpanzees making the forecasts. They're off by 10 to 15 degrees off, That's horrible. You're gonna go picnicking if you all this stuff. If it's blazing hot, you're gonna change your plans. Same if it's really cool or rainy or something, right? You need to know. Predicting heat is very important. Then they've just been derelict, utterly derelict at it. It's astonishing. The only ones that get it right are the TV, but I don't watch TV because then they hit you with all that other stuff. So it's a big issue for me, that this bad weather prediction, because it's tempting me to go back to television, which I most certainly won't do. You might as well hang yourself, rather than go back to television. I mean, it's like committing suicide. I don't want anyone to hang themselves, so don't do that. Okay. Absolutely not. None of us commit suicide here, okay? That's part of our path. No suicide, period. No excuses, period. The answer is get used to, get practice getting used to no, not having any excuses at all. And of course, that means no victimization, does it not? Yeah. Absolutely, you cannot believe in victimization in order to take this path. We're totally responsible for our lives and what we experience. Totally responsible. I know that a lot of times we want to blame some, do something to blame. When we want to blame somebody, which means an excuse for me, it's an excuse. Well, I can't meditate. I can't realize myself because I've been victimized, and I need to get retribution. I need an apology. I need a legal satisfaction, but I've been scarred. I've been damaged. Those are just excuses. None of them are true. This very instant, we can shift to the vertical perspective, and everything is settled. It's all settled just like that. All regrets, scars, blah, 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 gone. We see from the right perspective, we see, oh, nothing's ever happened at all, meaning no process has ever taken place at all. So how could there be any excuses? In order to make an excuse, you have to believe in process, time, space, process, form. You have to. So you cannot believe in victimization at all. You cannot. Jesus says this is primary, is right. I mean, he brought up a lot of stuff that's absolute repentance, no victimization, all this stuff. This is true in any path you take. And then he gave a sort of specific way to practice with people. Because some people are very sociable, they're always around people. I'm not that way at all. I realized that, wow, people are just trying to use me for excuse making, basically. I just don't go for that. Now, you might be asking, as I just asked myself, but what about all these lawsuits, Let's say Hillary wins, she's likely to win. You're going to be under the gun, totally. Totally under the gun. Or there may be martial law declared by the number 44, and we'll be under his gun. And he's a vicious, vicious lawsuit user, to say the least. He's able to completely suppress his entire past, make up a phony past, and hide everything he wanted to hide about himself by using, he has a team of lawyers working for him. He has so many lawyers working for him behind the scenes, crushing anything that could bother his image. He's manufactured this image, and he has these team of lawyers protecting it at all costs. And they are vicious lawyers, maybe more vicious than Trump's. So behind the scenes of these smiling figureheads, you have a snarling pack of hyenas who will eat you alive if you dare tarnish this smiling figurehead image. Keep that in mind. Trump's more open about it. You know, yeah, I got lawyers, they're pit bulls. You come after me and try to destroy my life, I'm coming after you. He's open about it. That's more helpful than being deceitful about it. Whereas number 44 and Hillary, I mean, they smile like I'm a cutie pie, or I'm this real wonderful, nice man, you know. Meanwhile, they got these hordes of hyenas who will leave nothing but a skeleton behind, and have done so many times. They don't tell you that, do they? Whereas Trump says, yeah, I got pit bull lawyers. You just canceled my contract because I wanted to run for president and say no more excuses, America. And so you just canceled my contract. And guess what? I'm not letting you get away with that. Meet my lawyers. They're terrible. They're pit bulls. Well, okay. That's how, you know, that's how the law is supposed to work. Is you're not supposed to be able to intimidate somebody ideologically by saying, if you don't bow to my ideology, I'm going to cancel this business contract. So we said, wait a minute, that wasn't in the business contract. You didn't say I couldn't run for president, and now you're canceling it. That's violates the terms of the contract. And he's right about that. They retroactively say, well, wait a minute, you know, it's not a good image for us now you're running for president. So, well, wait a minute, I'm an American citizen, I'm free to run for president. That's an honored right we have. And we should, just like you say, then I can't run for Senate? No, you can't do that. How about governor? No. You mean I can't run for office at all? No. You mean I can't have a say in culture? No. Really? That's not what American business is about. We have the right to speak up ideologically without having our contracts canceled. But that is, they're trying to crush that. They're trying to crush it. So you can only be a slave at Jack in the Box or something. It's okay if you have your tattoos there or whatever, you know, but you can't have any influence on culture whatsoever unless you kowtow to the yoga girl philosophy. And legally, they'll sue you. They'll cancel contracts, and you got no recourse. How do you like that, America? No recourse. This is what's coming. A legal dictatorship is what's coming. The real dictatorship is a legal dictatorship that you have no legal recourse. Isn't that what dictators do? No legal recourse? You get Hillary Clinton, you'll have no legal recourse whatsoever. Or if we get martial law, which is also another strong possibility, no recourse, no legal recourse whatsoever. You just shut up and be a good little slave. Isn't having legal recourse the way out of slavery? Isn't that what Magna Carta and you know, the various, what are the various legal agreements that we've had throughout history? Is, you know what? We have a right to have our day in court and to be heard. And we have a right to express our dissenting opinions without being struck down. And if you try to strike us down, we have a right to take you to court, even if you're the king or the queen. Well, it's more difficult to take the queen to court. No one ever said we can take the queen to court. They said we could take the king to court, but sometimes the queen was held accountable too, which was quite shocking to the old guard matriarchy. They said, we got to get rid of this. Yeah, sue the king. You know, cut the king's head off, but not the queen's. Not Marie Antoinette. What, are you kidding me? Can't do that, huh? So legal dictatorship is coming. So what do you do about it? Good question. Practice not having excuses is what you do about it. This world's not going to be a friendly place going forward. I can tell you that. What do you do about it? Practice not making any excuses. Being without excuses. Don't try to get rid of excuses. Just practice being without excuses. Which means drop your thinking one way or the other. Drop your grasping. Drop your strategizing. Drop your attempt to gain some advantage in some way. Drop any attempt to gain any advantage whatsoever and just sit in the wow of this. Wow. The glimpsing of reality is so important. Jesus calls it the holy instant. He says that's key, which it's the same in all traditions. Glimpsing the holy instant. Glimpsing the process-free moment, the now. Glimpsing that. And there's no excuses. There's no needed. And then wowing that. That's the path. Just wow it. I'm kind of enjoying my Saturday morning without working out. I've been working out every single day, just hammering it. I tell you what, anytime you do something you're not used to doing, you feel so tired. I got to work on some stuff today that dancing backwards, doing dance backward band step, that's part of dancing, is doing two-step going backwards and then double your tap going backwards. I was like almost falling. I'm like, what? I can do like one tap, you know, step, tap, step, tap, step, tap, step, tap, go back and forth. And you can just tap yourself. But then double tap, 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 going backwards. Dun, 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 dun. I was like, whoa, I'm going to fall, losing my balance. Like, what? I can run up a mountain and I can't double tap going backwards? Yeah. Wow. I got this bounce ball. It's called a BOSU ball. BOSU standing for both sides utilized. BO stands for both. BOTH, both. S stands for sides and U stands for utilized. So BOSU ball. The BOSU ball. Oh, it's right here. It's a half dome. A rubberized, and this is a real strong rubberized half dome, and there's all these practices that you can do. There's a booklet comes up, but I'm not really interested in any of those practices. You know, this guy, it's like, what I did was I put it in a tire, and this half dome rests in the open space of a tire, but not entirely. And then I stand on the flat platform, and it's just like standing on a surfboard, actually, or a skateboard, very similar. It's very wobbly, and you have to like keep your balance as it's wobbling as you're riding the wave. Of course, the waves always chop and uneven surfaces, and you're just like, whoa, your balance is always being thrown off, and you just have to, you know, constantly be able to reassert your balance, keep your balance on the move as it's, you're losing it from every direction. You have to be really relaxed and calm, and not let your mind freak out and say, oh, I'm going this direction. Uh-oh. No, you just... So you practice 360-degree instability on this BOSU ball with a tire. I wrap the tire with a shrink wrap. Or not, what do you call it, shrink wrap? Plastic wrap. A plastic wrap, so it's not all dirty. You know, this is cross-training. So I use stuff in integral training. I combine the BOSU ball with a tire, and it's like, that's not in the manual at all. But this is actually better training. It's fabulous training, actually. My God, and you can make it as unstable as you want by how fast you move. You can simulate like going down a big wave where your board's just chattering like crazy, or skiing. Your skis are like chattering like crazy, and your legs go. You can simulate this on the BOSU ball with a tire really, really well. Really well. God, your legs are just going this way, vibrating like all this different direction. And the upper body's got to be, you know, graceful, calm, and you're not worried like, oh my God, what's happening? You don't look down, your ski's like, why is it chattering so much? Or how am I going to fall? No, you just have to be able to handle that chatter calmly. You know, and it's your perceptions on what's up ahead, what's my line I'm going to take, like this. skiing, surfing, skateboarding, that puts your body under all this just that kind of stress. So this simulates it extremely well. So my legs are just, oh man, that gives different muscles, having to keep this rapid adjustment and keep your balance like this. It really just hammers your legs in a different way. I mean, if you're just like a jogger, that's all you do, try this and you'll just say, oh my God, I just crushed my legs. I'm so sore. I'm so tired. Wow. And then if you think you're in good shape, try dancing. I'm not a good dancer. I've never practiced dancing, but I get so tired, it's ridiculous. Because I'm nervous and I'm saying, whoa, this way, I'm supposed to go this way, I don't know, I don't know, what? Because so the unexpected movements, and you get used to moving, and the dancers just gracefully gliding, because they know exactly what they're doing, where they're going, and they're relaxed. So it's really helpful to practice unexpected. I'm going this way, now this way, now this way, now this way. This helps actually, in some subtle way, it helps us practice no excuses. Because our thoughts are going every which way, right? And we don't really pay attention to any of our thoughts. Doesn't really matter which direction they're going in. Doesn't matter which direction the illusion of process is going in. There is no process. So, I'm inventing some training techniques that I've never seen anywhere. Bosu ball with a tire, I think, is probably an invention. Maybe somebody else has done this somewhere, which is great. But for me, it's an original invention, and it's a fabulous invention. I'm also putting sand in PVC pipes. I did that yesterday. I now have one that's 3/4 inch, 1 inch, 1 1/4, and 1.5 inches. 10 foot long lengths, full of sand. Cap both ends capped, of course, so the sand doesn't come out. And I'm using these for all these shaker exercises and stuff, and different. Diameters give different outcome. The 3/4 diameter is too whippy. The vibration is too far, and the ends hit the ground. Okay. Now, if you want gentle exercise, if you're like elder or a more gentle type of person workout, then 3/4 inches it can be utilized nicely. If you want a more strenuous workout, 1 inch is great. 1 inch is the most versatile. You get the maximum whip without hitting the ground, and you get a very intense workout with 1 inch. It's perfect 1 inch PVC. You can make it 1 inch PVC, two caps, a stick of 10 foot 1 inch PVC is about $5 probably. Two caps is another dollar, $6. The amount of sand you put in is like about 50 cents worth of sand. Get a bag of sand, get a funnel, and then angle the tube. Get up on some high area bench or some angle the tube so you can pour the sand in through the funnel. Get a scoop and then pour it into the funnel. It goes into the PVC. Fill it up, put a cap on it, tape the cap, or you can use glue. I glue one end and tape the other end. So if I want to put something else in there, like water or lead shot or something, I can do it. But you can cap both ends if you want. 1 inch works great diameter. Get Schedule 40. It's tough enough. It doesn't snap when you're doing really, really strong exercises. Then you can get 1 1/4. Also works great. It gives you a very, very even more intense workout. And then 1.5, you really have to be strong to get the flex out of that. But that'll give you just a very intense. And if you do that one arm, the 1.5 with this one arm like that, it's strong. In order to flex it, you really have to push it hard. So, but all around, 1 inch, I found out now by just experimenting, 1 inch is great. You'll be happy with that for sure. So you could make this great dualist workout to help you stabilize, as far as duality. You got both ends are flexing on you. Flex, 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 flex. And it's trying to throw you off balance. And you're able to stay like almost immobile as both these ends are whipping around on you. Like this. And just if you have the strength to just push a little bit, like to do it, it's trying to throw your whole body out of whack, and your body's just able to remain stable like this. It's a great stability practice and strength practice. So get a 10-foot stick of Schedule 40 1-inch PVC irrigation pipe. Get two Schedule 40 caps that go on the end of it. And get some sand and a funnel. I got a funnel for $1.90 or something. It's kind of got like about the diameter cross diameter is what you call it would be about 3/4 of an inch. Yeah, because it matches up with the 3/4 just on the top. So like 3/4 inch funnel, if you can find them. Auto store will have something probably, or a hardware store. Or you can make your own paper funnel, some sort of funnel. Or you can just pour it in carefully. I use my hand sort of as a funnel and poured it in. But I spilled, you know, you spill some if you do that. You spill a little sand. Just be aware of that. That's fine. It's just sand. And so this is a great cross training. This is one of the aids that we're using right now. Now you got to be very careful with the BOSA ball and the tire to have a wide diameter tire, big tire, not the smaller ones. If it sits up too high, if it doesn't sit down in the tire enough, it should only be like an inch or two sticking up from the tire. If it's sitting up too high, if you get too much on the edge of the BOSA ball, it can flip the flat part. It can flip. So be aware that. Is a tricky exercise, and don't undertake it without doctor's clearance, right? You can fall on that. Like anything you do, you have to be, don't jump into it. You've got to be aware. So I will find out how wide the diameter needs to be. It looks like it needs to be at like maybe 2 feet, fairly big tire, like a big truck tire, some sort of truck tire. The half dome has to nestle down in. I'll show you. It has to nestle down into it pretty far, so you still get the stability. But if you step on the edge, it's not going to flip on you. The tire is very stable, but the BOSA ball, if it's sitting up, you could also deflate this. If the tire is small, you deflate it so it sits down further, kind of way, and it's not going to. You just have to make sure it's not going to suddenly flip on you. I almost flipped yesterday. I realized, wow, okay, you got to be careful with this. And you could just put the BOSA ball on the ground too and do the same thing, actually. It's a little different. The simulation's a little different with the tire, but you don't need a tire, actually. You could just put it right on the ground, the dome part, and it's like a surfboard too. Like skiing, like surfboard, etc. It's just different variations give slightly different experiences. Just like the, so just put it on the ground, that's fine. And then put the flat part on the ground and step on it and just practice moving on top, and all because constant instability causes you to not fixate. You practice not fixating on any excuses. As soon as your mind starts making an excuse for like, oh, there's an excuse to fall, guess what? You start to fall. So when you're being thrown off balance real rapidly like this, you trained your mind not to make excuses. That's why really great athletes, they tend to not be excuse makers. They're in the now. They're very much in the now. No excuses. I'll let the other guys make excuses for why they failed. That's the way Tiger Woods used to be. He's never made excuses. When he lost his confidence, then he was constantly making excuses. It's very sad to see. Ah, bad lie. Ah, bad luck here. Ah, I didn't swing right. Ah, and he was like cursing himself, getting really frustrated and angry. That means he'd lost his confidence. When you have your confidence, you don't make any excuses at all. Refuse to make excuses. That's how his dad trained him. Don't allow your mind to make any excuses at all. Somebody coughed while you were swinging, no excuse. And then when Tiger lost his confidence, somebody made any move or coughed when he was swinging, he'd stop his swing and glare at them and start cursing and says, hey, that's an excuse. You give me an excuse. Don't give me. He's losing it. Where's the real? When you have your confidence, it doesn't matter what people are doing. You say, I'm not making any excuses at all. I refuse to make any excuses for my performance. And that's how you perform the best. He says, because whatever happens, I've got the shot. Whatever happens, I've got the skill to overcome whatever happens. And I just stay fresh. I just stay in that confidence. All I do is just stay in that confidence. Nothing rattles me. Well, my ball's in a divot. I got that shot. I know how to hit that shot. No problem. Ball's in the rough. I can deal with that just fine. There's some trees there. It's okay. I can hook it around them. It's great. It just gives me a chance to show my skills. Not a problem at all. No excuses. I don't need an excuse. I'm going to succeed anyway. I don't need any excuse. I'm going to succeed anyway. Well, you catch a glimpse of reality, you realize I've already succeeded. In fact, there's no way I can fail. So, why am I worried about, why do I need to make an excuse? Don't need to make any excuses. I don't need to listen to any excuses. The excuse making, we call that the, you know, small mind or something, but it's just our excuse habit. Egoic mind, excuse is just excuses we're making. Ego's not making them, we're making them really. And just imagining something else is making them for us. So it's out of our control, you know. Oh, I can't control it. So the ego's making excuses, not me. I can't control that. No, it's not true. Ego's just a term we use for all these excuses we're making them. We don't need to follow any of them. They're going in all different directions, 360 different degrees. All this, they're going. That's fine. We don't even follow them at all. We just sit quietly in neutral as it is. Now, the muscle memory of these athletes is so good, the mind's not even thinking about the body. It's not even thinking about it at all. So, like in golf, I said, wow, I know I'd have to put a lot of work in this, into golf, to get even more close to where I want to be. I don't have the time for that. I don't have the money for it either, that's for sure. And it's not important. I just use golf as a meditation aid anyway. And so now I have better meditation aids, you know, to practice, simulate, same as surfing. I don't need to surf. I can use the Bosa ball to simulate surfing. And that really helps spiritually, actually. So keep the Bosa ball on the ground, folks. Okay, forget about the tire. That's just an innovation. But I have different types of tires and stuff, and you got to really know how to dial it in. I'll see what's best, but for now, keep it on the ground, and it won't flip on you. Don't inflate it too much. It can get too wobbly. You want it a little bit underinflated, so it sticks to the ground a little better. It's not so severe. And you can come up with your own exercises. The sidewalk surfing. Instead of riding the waves surfboard, we're riding the Bosa ball. So don't make excuses. Don't say, well, you told me to use the tire. No, I said, look, check out your exercise and be careful. It won't flip on you. If you stand on the edge, put your weight in the edge, it doesn't, you know, suddenly flip like that. Just like riding a skateboard. I mean, if you ride a skateboard, you got to be careful about everything, right? Just because someone sells you a skateboard, they're not liable for you having an accident. If someone tells you, yeah, skateboarding is good for you, they're not liable for it. You're liable for how you use something. If someone sells you a pair of skis, are they liable if you crash? No, you took the risk. When you exercise, you're taking risks. I understand any use of your body is risky. Getting in a car is very risky, actually. It certainly was for my cousin. You are responsible for your life, period. The yoga girls will say, of course, now sue. Have an accident and then sue. Establish your superiority over them. Agree to some situation and then later claim you were victimized and then sue them and infantize them so that you're big mother and you rule them and say, this is what mom wants you to do. You do this, mom's happy. You do this, mom's not happy. Guess what happens when mom's not happy? No food for you. So keeping mom happy is your purpose in life. This is what some of the yoga girls who took Course in Miracles came up with. It says, keeping women happy is the purpose of men's life. Keeping mom happy is the purpose of life. And guess what? Jesus agrees with this, and A Course in Miracles agrees because I'm an expert on A Course in Miracles. No, they're experts on being yoga girls and using intimidation and manipulating your addiction. And what happened was they saw A Course in Miracles and it freaked them out. They said, my God, if people listen to this, they won't be addicts anymore. And how am I going to get my condo in Florida? How am I going to be this yoga comfort yoga girl my whole life and get and enslave men? I won't be able to. They'll be free. This is terrible. So they said, wow, I need to be really become an expert on this. Let me start publishing books. Everybody thinks I'm an expert. Let me put all this pseudo-spirituality love talk around it so people think I'm some sort of expert. And then they'll listen to me and not actually say, you don't need to listen to A Course in Miracles. You can listen to me, you know. And they become the guru on A Course in Miracles. Hey, there's the Virgin Mary complex, isn't it? Hey, you don't need to listen to Jesus. Of course, she never said that, but they put words in her mouth. You listen to me, you know. I'll tell you what he has to say. So that's the yoga girl thing. Don't listen to A Course in Miracles. I'll tell you what it has to say. Don't worry. It didn't work on me because I studied A Course in Miracles, you know, for 15 years nonstop. I did, you know, been paid. Jesus said, don't pay attention to that. Just keep getting more and more familiar. So it doesn't work, but it works on a lot of other people for sure. And they say, oh yeah, the purpose of a badge, yeah. Keep a woman happy. That's your purpose. Do what mom says. Keep mom happy. Because you know what happens if you don't keep mom happy. Right? No, actually not. Oh, well, let us remind you. So Hillary's their girl, you know? She's their yoga girl. Get Hillary in office and all these yoga girls are going to be able to now to bring the hammer down. Bring the hammer down on everyone. And they're everywhere. Okay, they're in every corporation, they're in every business, they're in every recreation, they're everywhere you go. The yoga girls are there, and they're waiting to bring the hammer down full blast, full impact, hammer all the nails down. And she'll basically say, give them the go signal, just like number 44 gave a lot of various activists the go signal. Without saying anything, you just wink, wink, nod, nod, don't worry. I got your back. Do whatever you want to do. I won't sick the Justice Department on you. It's tacitly understood, of course. The president rules the judicial, the justice system, the attorney general and all this stuff. I mean, the attorney general decides what to prosecute. Hello. What to emphasize. There's something they got your back on. They say, I'm not. They say the attorney general in some states is, no, we're not prosecuting that. Keep in mind, this whole federal apparatus runs through attorney generals, federal prosecutors through in every state. They all answer to the chief federal prosecutor, which is the attorney general. Attorney general is the most powerful person in the land, next to the president, socially. So, you know, you want to riot, you want to do this, you want to shoot police, you want to be able to turn your well, you know, it's the police's fault. We're not going to prosecute you, you know. Back off, attorney general's down there. Back off. Yeah, and then civil lawsuits gets involved, but, so what's happened is the presidency has learned to use the judicial system as a weapon against the American people. And this has become now just pretty much acceptable among the liberals, for sure. Whereas the conservatives say, no, that's not fair. That's not American. They say, well, we've changed the rules of what being America is all about. It's time for the yoga girls to run everything. And all nails to be hammered down. And that's the way it's going to be now. Sorry. ask sorry what to do, huh? Yeah, ask mom what to do. We're now going to have mom running the show. She's going to say, this is what keeps me happy, and this is what mommy doesn't like. And you know what happens when you do what mommy doesn't like. And you can't say, well, the Constitution protects me about when mommy doesn't do what I don't do what mommy likes, because mommy has to abide by the Constitution too. And they're saying, not anymore. Not anymore. Because we got mommy as president. And she makes the rules now. She decides how the what the federal prosecutors do, what the entire federal bureaucracy does, which is the whole purpose is for this dictatorship to take place is to crush local bureaucracy and make it subservient to federal bureaucracy. That's called the New World Order, folks. Conservatives want to keep local bureaucracy powerful. because that's a protection against federal bureaucracy being a dictatorship, which is why the Constitution was set up to prevent federal takeover of states and localities. The whole purpose of the Constitution is checks and balances, so we don't have an out-of-control dictatorship. Well, the liberals have subverted the Constitution to such a point where they feel they're able now to completely junk it, actually, maybe with martial law, and have a federal bureaucracy just completely dominate our entire society, which means the president is a dictator, because the president puts in all the cabinet posts, ministerial posts, etc., put in their own hand-picked people, and they can pretty much get them agreed to, because they need a two-thirds majority to block them in a lot of cases. And it's very difficult to block these appointees. Very difficult. So, you know, you throw in Attorney General, who you know that she's completely simpatico with turning a blind eye to all this extreme mischief, and is going to go after the ones you want to crush. Oh yeah, hey, guess what? You're Attorney General now. It's your lucky day. Just imagine the cabinet that Hillary Clinton is going to have. Just imagine it. I mean, don't. I mean, it'll freak you out. It's not just the president. It's all the appointees who are running the apparatus of the federal bureaucracy. That's what's important. Because that's what hits you in the gut. Those are the ones that actually then start pounding you at the local level where you live. That's hitting you where you live. It's all the appointees, all the judges you appoint. Okay. That's what's important. That's why you never want one party to have too much power for too long, because they can completely stack the judiciary, which you don't want. That then causes the country to come apart. You get the Supreme Court deciding that the Constitution doesn't matter anymore. They become so politicized. They're supposed to be loyal to the Constitution. Now they're loyal to political parties. And then the country collapses. The Constitution's thrown out. And you get dictatorship. You get Big Mommy telling you what she likes and what she does and what makes her angry. And some stuff makes her really, really angry. Like, Mommy, you have to abide by the Constitution too. No, that makes me really, really angry. And you know what happens when I get really, really angry. Yeah. So, you know, goodbye, America. It's been gone since the last election, actually. That's what I said. The previous election was the end of America. It was the 212 election. That was the end of America. You get too far out of balance. You get stacked the judiciary too much. That's it. If you give 16 years to these folks, you'll never recover. America will never recover. It's finished. It's finished. I'm into rotating. 4 years with this one, 4 years this, 8 years this one, 8 years this, you know, whatever. You got to keep the balance. You know, you cannot stack the judiciary and the bureaucracy, because they all get used to it. They all get comfortable. Fat cats. They get cronyism. Bureaucratic cronyism comes in severely. This is what the whole Constitution is. America was designed to prevent all this, because this is history. It was designed to prevent all the injustices of history, the terrible stuff that creeps in. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. And if you have one party in power for 16 years, which is what we're looking at, it'll be so corrupt, you'll never recover. Never recover. There'd have to be like a civil war revolution to recover from it. And that's not likely to happen. They have that covered too. So it's going to be terrible. Terrible. That's why Jesus already invited me to his place. Says, you want to come visit my house? I'd love to have you there. I'm inviting you there. He invited me directly, invited me. Didn't invite me through the Virgin Mary. He invited me directly. Because I don't need anybody to make invitations for me. I'll invite you. I can invite you directly. How about that? He didn't need the Pope to invite me, the church to invite me. He invited me directly. And I said, yeah, I'd love to. I'd love to. That's a big yes. He says, great. I said, where is it? It's right here. It's real close. Real close by. Okay. Wonderful. Now, the euphemism Arizona stands for those who standing up for the Constitution more than anybody. They said, hey, wait a minute. The Constitution matters to us, older people, a lot of retirees down there, and the Constitution matters to them. They're not above the Constitution, and guess what? Nobody is. Hillary Clinton's not above the Constitution, even though she thinks she is. 44 is not above the Constitution, even though he's sure that he is. They say, no, nobody's above it. Not even Ronald Reagan's above the Constitution. These are older people. They're retirees in Arizona. A lot of older people retire to Arizona. And they say, hey, wait a minute. This is totally unconstitutional what you're doing. We're not going to let you get away with that. So there's this massive hatred for Arizona in the country. The liberals hate Arizona. You know, and don't be surprised if sabotage takes place in Arizona. Don't be surprised. Don't be surprised at all, actually. They would love to create chaos in Arizona, actually. So Arizona is a euphemism for a reduced intensity zone, a reduced intensity zone, meaning those who don't want to live under a dictatorship and feel like there's some principles that are spiritually helpful, and they're willing to put up with the instability of that. They understand it. It's ragged, but it's better than a dictatorship. From their spiritual standpoint, it is absolutely it is. You just have to handle the instability of it, the checks and balances of it, and you know that's being American is putting up with that. If you can't handle it, go somewhere else. America, love it or leave it. You don't love the way it is, leave it. But now they say, no, come on in. You don't love it? Great. Come on in. We want you here. We want as many people as possible here who hate America. That's what they're doing. Open borders. People come here don't love America. They love the money they make, but they don't love the Constitution at all. Some do. Some do. A lot don't. They could care less. They say, I just want money. I just want a car. I just want material things. As far as the legal system is concerned, I don't even know what it is. I could care less about it. Guess what? An American is supposed to be schooled in the Constitution. It's called civics. You have to pass your civics class if you want to continue on in school. Our schooling is designed for us to respect the Constitution and law and order under the Constitution and realize it's not always fair in every single which way. That's why there's checks and balances, different parties, you know, you tweak it this way, you tweak it that way. Not everybody's going to be happy. I'm not always going to be happy with stuff. Deal with it. That's what American, you have to deal with it. And that's a lot better than the alternative. There is no perfect system. And accepting the fact that there's no perfect system is the best system. That's true. It's true. Other than having the Tibetan, you know, Nyingma masters run everything, which is better. There'd be a theocratic spiritual practice system, but we're not mature enough for that. So it's a wonderful focus to have. Okay, don't lose sight of that. Ultimately, that's the best. But on the way to that, democracy, American democracy, constitutional democracy is the best system. But there's not nearly enough people in America who are tough enough and will and care enough to keep it going. So it's very likely to implode. So what do you do if you're an Arizonaite, which realizes it's the best system there is, and we don't dare junk it because our spiritual advancement is going to go down the drain. Most certainly will. Well, maybe you migrate. To a reduced intensity zone. Maybe there'll be a migration, a refugee situation. This is what I was shown in the dream, that I was a refugee from this terrible situation in the world where of crystallized excuses. My excuses are right, yours are wrong, and I'm going to use the law to destroy you. I had to migrate. I had to flee that. I had to flee like fleeing from a battleground. And I was a refugee, and I found this other realm, and I said, I'm a refugee from this terrible situation. You understand? Can I stay here? And they said, absolutely, of course you can. We were expecting you. We were expecting you. We know all about this situation. We already set up this place for you to take refuge in. And I said, wow. And I looked around. It was so beautiful. The muscle car thing is part of this whole thing. Is, you know, my horsepower is better than your horsepower. And of course, the luxury car things is a Tesla and Audi. Also, I mean, my horsepower is better than your power. And then the Prius, my environmental helpfulness is better than yours. You know, it's something. You know, mine is better than yours. And it's getting now closest. Is mine is right and yours is completely wrong. Used to be, hey, I got something really great, and you got something that's really great. Cool. Let's make it even better. Now it's mine is right, yours is wrong. You don't see any people anymore that says, hey, mine is just really great, and that's it. No, they say mine is great, and yours over there, it's really, really bad. It's terrible. You don't get that. So. Not getting that is terrible. Okay, that's the terribleness I'm pointing out. I can live with people with different viewpoints. Sure, I can live with, you know, feminism's viewpoints. In fact, I welcome feminism. I say, yeah, it's fine. It's a different viewpoint. But that wasn't what it was really about. The activists co-opted it, stole it. So we certainly can't live with that. No way. We can't live with this legal dictatorship coming. Unconstitutional legal dictatorship is coming. So migration is certainly, in some way, is certainly possible. Very possible. Look at the refugees in Europe. Didn't they migrate? Yeah. I bet you a lot of them thought it's not possible. But they said, we got to try it anyway. They got to the Mediterranean and they, you know, found boats somehow and went across the Mediterranean Sea and found, somehow disembarked in Greece or somewhere and started fanning out through the countryside, taking trains and just say, we're here, you know, we're not going back. And the Europeans said, what the heck are we going to do with, you know, with this? Well, some of them are taking them in. But what we need to focus on now, who's going to take us in from fleeing this world, actually? Who's going to take us in? Where can we go and to flee this world? It's almost a fait, you know, fait accompli, you could say. Even if Trump wins, they'll never let him govern. They won't let him govern. No way. No way. They will hit him with so many lawsuits, they will just cause legal gridlock and won't let him govern at all. And then that'll force him into, you know, trying to take stronger powers, you know, and the whole thing will just absolutely deteriorate into civil war, probably. Keep in mind, the ego schools us all that lack of excuses, no excuses, is an abyss, a total abyss, and you can never free yourself from the abyss. You don't know where you are. It's like annihilation, spiritual annihilation. This is what the ego tells us. So most in the world are doubling down on excuses. Let's have twice as many. That's just twice as many. Let's be twice the victimization. Let's all be victims and learn victim consciousness. How are we doing? We're almost there, aren't we? Yeah. So grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me. Get used to being on the side. We're not going out riding those big waves. With Laird Hamilton, he's sitting on the beach. He says, hey, okay, everybody, I'm going to go skateboarding. How about you? Or I'm going to go simulate skateboarding. How about you? Don't jump on a skateboard if you're older. I haven't jumped on it yet at all. I did it on a carpet. It's a lot safe on a carpet. The wheels sink in. On concrete? No. It's a whole different story. I haven't tried it yet. So I'm not recommending you go skateboarding. Okay, I'm recommending you use it as a symbol. It also helps remind you of the importance of stability and balance and how treacherous the world is right now. Very treacherous. It's a, you got a skateboard, you're right. Hey, this, you know, this is potential trouble, right? Yeah, skateboards, you know, you could wipe. I've wiped out many times on skateboards, believe me, when I was young. I was pretty cautious, though. I wasn't that good because I didn't want to wipe out. There are a lot of guys who didn't care. You know, they were daredevils, and they wipe out real badly. But they bounce back and jump on, and they just no fear, you know. Oh, so they ended up then mastering some of the more difficult stuff. Whereas me, I said, nah, I was kind of a scaredy cat. I played it safe. I tend to play it safe, which is great. Because now I'm saying don't go out in those waves. Play it safe. That's exactly the right advice. The last thing you want to be is a daredevil right now. So go out and buy a skateboard today. I know the skate shops will love me for that. But don't skateboard on it. No. I'm not telling anybody to skateboard. I'm saying we're using that as a symbol, satsang symbol here, of playing it safe. We'll be playing on the sidewalk. Okay, that's where the kids are. Yeah, we're like kids right now. So I'm not ready yet for to stand on the skateboard. I'm not ready yet. When and if I am, then I will. You know, I'll feel it. But my legs are too tired right now. I mean, I can't even dance without losing my balance because I'm tired. I'm tired. So don't do stuff when you're really tired. Okay, so again, I'm not asking.